I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I met you. I was breathing but not alive. All my failures I tried to hide. It was my turn, yeah, till I met you. You call my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day. You call my name and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness.
Hey, New Hope. I'm going to bring you a bunch of information about all the changes taking place at New Hope. I want to remind you, first of all, that we are praying September, the month of September, the 1st through the 30th. We're going to have a prayer meeting every Monday night at 6 o'clock at the church. We want you to join in as we pray for the elections. We pray that voters would sign up and register to vote. We're going to pray for our nation, and we're going to pray for our church, for believers, and we're going to pray that God helps us open the doors to go back inside. I also want you to know another thing that's very important. We're shifting to a complete small group system throughout the days at New Hope, all the week long, and we want you to be aware that you can be a host. It's very simple to be a host, and we especially need people that will host Zoom meetings. We'll train you, we'll give you all the materials to make it happen. We just need you to host it and be a part of it. You can go to our website at New Hope Community Church and check us out and get all the information for small groups and how you can sign up. We're diving into 40 days in the Word starting September 20th on Sunday and Wednesday, September 23rd. We want everybody involved in these small groups. God bless you. Have an awesome day.
Fear. So glad you're joining us today. We are in chapter 18 of the book of John, and I'm just really excited about shoring up all these great Bible studies. There's been a string of just fantastic insight every Wednesday night. And so we're going to continue a few more weeks, and then Pastor is going to finish us off in this Bible study. But let's jump into it. Oh, also, if you are not subscribed to YouTube, that'd be a miracle if you're watching it right now and you're not subscribed. But please get the word out. Subscribe to our YouTube channel, because we're going to have more things that are going to come up. Also with social media, Facebook, and Instagram, make sure you follow us, and then also put on all your notifications so it lets you know when things are happening with certain things throughout the week, all right? And also, make sure you go to our website all the time. On our homepage, we have all the newest announcements. If you have not subscribed to our New Hope News, go over to Get Connected on our homepage, press Get Connected, and then you're going to see subscribe to New Hope News. Just hit that. You're going to put in your information, and then you're going to get weekly updates in your email, because you'll be on New Hope News. All right, let's do this. Let's pray real quick. Father, thank you for our time together. May it be enriching, and may we discover something in your word that kind of highlights something special that hits home within us. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, I'm going to read from chapter 18, verses 1 through 11. So join me. This is Gospel of John. When he had finished, meaning Jesus, when he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. On the other side, there was a garden, and he had set off with his disciples to go into it. Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. Now that gets me right there. Jesus and the disciples are at the garden. That was a special place where they would pray, where they bonded together. It was just kind of like that place where you had good memories of being together and praying together. This is the place Judas is betraying them. That's just wrong in that. So, verse 3. So Judas came to the garden, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and Pharisees. So these are kind of like the cohort. It's the soldiers that are surrounding. It said there was about 200 that were coming out to arrest Jesus. We'll talk a little bit more about that. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. And Judas the traitor was standing there with them, the soldiers. They drew back. Then they said, when Jesus said this, "I am he." Now, this is real interesting, because it said after Jesus said, "I am he," it said that they drew back. These soldiers drew back and they fell to the ground. Come on, something's going on here. Again, he asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said. Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. If you were looking for me, then let these men go." This happened so that the words that was spoken would be fulfilled. "I have not lost one of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter had a sword. He drew it out and he struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his ear. The servant's name was Malchus. Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup of the Father has given me?" Then Jesus picked up the man's ear and attached it back to his head. And I'm going to stop right there. There's a lot here and a lot of great insight. To put it in context, it's the disciples, they just finished supper. It was the Last Supper, and they walked down from that room they were in, and they were walking over to the Garden of Gethsemane. On their way over there, it's really important, or it's really mind-boggling in this story when you kind of read a little bit more of what's taking place. They're walking from the Last Supper to the Garden of Gethsemane, and there was the Valley of Kidron. And there, from there flowed kind of like a creek that went through their pathway going to Gethsemane. And it was the creek where the blood would flow down from the sacrifices of the lambs at the temple. So I want you to put this picture together. The timing was pretty close where they did all the sacrifices of the lambs for the forginess of sins as it was to be done by Jewish law. And so during that time, the blood of the lambs were flowing through the Valley of Kidron. So when the disciples and Jesus were walking to the Garden of Gethsemane, they had to cross this creek where there was blood flowing down from the lamb. And you could just imagine what Jesus was thinking as he was crossing through the sacrificial lambs and the blood that was flowing down. Just imagine what was going through the mind of Christ as they were making their journey to the arrest of Jesus. So when they finally get there, it said that it was a place that they went regularly. So this was a place of prayer. It was a place of rest. It was a place of safety. They're around olive trees. And matter of fact, these groves of olive trees were owned by very wealthy people. And Jesus was given the key because it was surrounded with gates. And so Jesus was given the key to the gates to go in. So it was a safe place that nobody knew where they were. It was kind of like that secret place, safe place where you can get alone with God and you're not bugged by other people. And so as I said earlier, that Judas knew they were there. And Judas, kind of number one, kind of put them on blast where their place was, they prayed. And number two, obviously, that he betrayed Jesus. There was going to be the arrest and everything that went with that. And so they're in the garden. The soldiers, they show up, and they're kind of in wide open area, you know, the disciples and Jesus. And you have to understand this. These soldiers. It was a mix of the Sanhedrin and Pharisees. It was kind of like their secret police. They were the ones who would enforce the law, and they would, if somebody that they didn't agree with, they would go after them. So imagine this kind of like secret police from the Sanhedrin and the Pharisees, and then the Roman soldiers who had lanterns, it said, torches, and they had weapons, okay? And when you kind of learn the soldiers and how they approached situations like this, they would have larger groups, and then they would have condensed groups when they went to arrest somebody. So it was said that there was about 200 soldiers that were in that group when they went to arrest Jesus and 11 other disciples. So just imagine how that was set up. So today I'm going to talk about this. Get ready. We're going to talk about five things. So five scenes in this passage in John 18, 1 through 11, that shows the qualities of Jesus. And so we're going to go through this really quick, and I want you just to see how special and how much Christ should mean to you in the midst of this story. And the first thing is this, is that it shows the courage of Jesus. And I love it because they walk right into the garden, and Jesus says, "Who are you looking for?" right off the bat. So he steps in front of the disciples like any man of courage and taking care of everybody else, and nobody else said anything. He said, "Who are you looking for?" And it just shows somebody who takes leadership, somebody who takes responsibility, someone who cares for other people, and they'll be at the forefront. And that's really who Jesus is, that he's full of courage, that he always would step up and say, "I want to deal with the conflict." And to think of a God that does that, that is continually a defender, full of courage, it kind of sets the tone for this story where he says, "I am he." And he says it three times because when you read the story, it's really interesting because he says, "Who are you looking for?" They said, "Jesus of Nazareth." And then he says, "I am he." And then it kind of gets quiet. And then he goes, "Well, who are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." And says, "I am he." And it says that they drew back and that they fell to the ground. And I'm reminded of just the authority of God. At that moment, I'm thinking that story should have just shifted completely, that they sensed the awe of God and they fell to the ground. If I was a Roman soldier, I would have been like, "Sanhedrin, Pharisees, you're on your own. We're out of here. This is not a good deal for us." But for whatever reason, God's will's still moving forward. And in that moment, I also think of at the very end, when Malchus, the soldier of the high priest, his ear was cut off and it fell to the ground. And Jesus picks up the man's ear that Peter cut off, and he puts it back on and attaches it, and the man's healed. I mean, in that moment, somebody should have said, I quit. I'm not a part of this. I'm not going to arrest this man. There's something about this man that is far beyond what we can even imagine. And so just the courage of Jesus setting himself the stone, stepping up and saying, I am he. I'm ready to be arrested. So that's the first thing that we see in this story is the courage of Jesus. The other thing, it shows his authority. It says, I am the man. And in the midst of all this, here's Jesus, the disciples, unarmed. And then you look at the cohort that comes to arrest him. It says that they had torches, they had lanterns, and they had weapons. So they were thinking they were going to go out into this garden and they were going to have to search for them. He may have been in a cave. They may have been hiding in the trees. They may have set up a fortress. They were ready for combat. And they get there and there's Jesus and the disciples in the wide open, just waiting for them to arrive. Jesus knew that they were coming and they were just in the wide open. And so we kind of see the authority that Christ has. And when you read that, they withdrew and they fell to the ground. There was a God authority there, that the fear of God was there. At the same time of Jesus being arrested, he was in full control. He had complete authority of the situation, and he knew what his job was to do, and that was to be arrested, be sentenced, and go to the cross and die for the sins of the world. So Jesus is in control. He's sovereign in everything that's taking place, and it's seen by Jesus taking the ear, placing it back on the man's head, and it being healed. God's in control of everything. Even when there's chaos, God's always in control. Here's number three. It shows us that Jesus chose to die. He wasn't hiding. He knew what he needed to fulfill according to Old Testament prophecy and scripture, that Jesus knew that he was going to die for the sins of the world. And I even shared with you earlier when they were walking through the valley from the Last Supper over to the valley, or over to Gethsemane, there was the valley and the creek of the blood from the lambs that were slain for the sins of the Jewish people, that was flowing down on their way to the Garden of Gethsemane, that Jesus was reminded that he was going to the cross, he was dying for the sins of the world, and he was choosing to do that because he had great love for his children. Number four is this. It shows his protective love. I love that part where Jesus steps up and he says, leave these men alone. He says, I am the one you're looking for. It is I you want. And if there is one thing that displays strong leadership, it's someone who steps up and takes responsibility and does the right thing in these kinds of circumstances. And you just see the strength of Jesus in this moment and how he protects. Matter of fact, it was to fulfill scripture from the Old Testament that none of them would be harmed, the disciples that he had, that none of them would be harmed, and that he was fulfilling the scripture in that moment. And so Jesus is our protector. Matter of fact, when you read throughout the Word of God, Old Testament and New Testament, you see that Christ is our protector. And here's the last one. We'll end with this, and then we'll pray. And I have one question for you afterwards as well, is it shows us the obedience to the mission. You know, when you're reading through the New Testament, you'll come across this statement that says that Jesus set himself to stone. It means that he knows the mission, and he's going to fulfill the mission. And it's all based out of his obedience to the Father. You know, in that moment when he was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane before the arrest, Jesus said, Lord, if this cup should pass, so be it, but your will is much more important than any other thing. And that was his prayer. Lord, your will be done over what I'm sensing and experiencing in my human side, but your will be done in this. And so you just see the obedience of Jesus when it comes to fulfilling the mission that God the Father had for him to die for the sins of the world and to resurrect and then ultimately come back for his church, full obedience to the Father. And so I want you to look at these five areas of the character of Christ and go over them and talk about them in your group and then come to a final time in prayer of just thanking Christ for these five areas of the qualities that he has, because they all benefit you as a believer and a Christ follower and a child of God. Well, let's do this. Let's pray and then have some great discussion afterwards. Father, I thank you for everybody today. And as we focused on those five qualities of Jesus that are found in the Garden of Gethsemane during the arrest, Lord, that we realize how much you love us, how much you're our protector, how much your courage has impacted our lives and all the other qualities, Lord. As we talk through those today, may we be reminded how much you love us and how much you care for us and how much you protect us. Lord, we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Well, God bless you. Have a good rest of the week. And make sure you join us Sunday if you're coming to the parking lot or if you get on church online or Facebook Live. Make sure you're with us Sunday morning. You don't want to miss anything that's coming out. God bless you.